what my eyes can't see, I still believe everything spoken to me. There's no word that could come back, boy. I will trust the report of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I will do anything just to see you, God. To behold you as my King.
Lord, please hear my heart.
your glory. You can do it. I want to see you and behold you as my King. It's your glory.
Not to us. I know about I'm being set free of me, I know somebody's got to be getting set free of them. You got the mic, you feel like you got to have something to say. You feel like you got to have something to do. And God has set me right on free. It's to you, God. Don't accept the pressure. Don't accept the pressure.
I'm here, Nora.
Whatever.
I'm here. Yes. He's dealing with that. Ain't no pressure. Amen. Just claim it.
Amen.
I was healed today. Amen. Actually, he completed the healing.
Amen.
And I praise and glorify his name.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
And I rebuke you, devil, because you're a liar.
Amen.
He's trying to take it from me, but I'm claiming healing.
Amen.
He says, speak it.
Amen.
You gotta speak it.
Yes.
And I worship you, and I'm saying I'm healed.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Glory to you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
When I say he completed the healing, because the devil's been working, and I rebuke, because I'm not trying to give him no glory. Long, long time ago. I suffered from MS. You'll never believe it. This is my first time testifying, giving my testimony. But I needed to, you know, to give him honor and glory.
Yes.
Amen. Yes.
Because I haven't stepped up.
Yes.
You know, and I got to step up.
Wow.
And give him honor.
Wow.
And I do, Lord. And I thank you.
Wow.
He healed me from MS.
Amen.
I walked in crutches. I was in a wheelchair.
Jesus.
Exacerbation. I don't know if anybody knows about the terminology, because I do work in nursing too. Exacerbation. Every year I was in the hospital with exacerbation, either falling down, because that's where it attacks the nervous system. You know, it debilitates you, you know, and you're weak. You can't hold nothing, you drop everything, or you get pain all over. Pain, extremely pain. Now mind you, I was in medication from 80. If anybody know OxyContin?
Yes.
They're addicted.
Yes.
And these doctors are addicted. That's why people are walking over here are like zombies.
Yes.
Because they claim they hurting something. And they go to the doctor, automatically they give them something for pain.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they just addicting them.
Yeah.
With drugs. Now I was in 80 milligrams.
Wow.
OxyContin.
Yeah.
Then 30 time release.
Oh, wow.
For the pain. But I was dry. I don't know how I could survive. People say, I don't know how you could take it. Because they take a little bit of that pill, they be zoned.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They couldn't function. I would work, I would drive cars, and they couldn't believe it. But you know what? Only the power of Christ kept me going.
Yes.
Just to finally, I say, God,
Jesus,
I'm tired.
Yes.
I'm tired of the pain.
Jesus.
Deliver me. And he knew my heart.
Yes.
He knew the pain. Yes. And the wanting, you have to want it. With all your heart.
Yeah.
And he heard my prayer.
Amen.
Mind you, I would try to just stop the medication. I couldn't. I had to have it. It was an addiction. And the pain, and the pain. That night when I prayed, he took it. I slept like a baby.
Hallelujah.
And I can say for 4 years now, going on 5, I've been healed. And now he healed me from the sight, because that was one of the exacerbations that took my eyesight. I went blind. And I went blind with this eye. I don't know this guy that came, Hosea. I gotta remember that name.
Josiah.
God used him because he don't know me from a can of paint.
Right.
You know, he don't know me. So when he said somebody here is blind from my right eye, I had to get up because it was only the good Lord.
Amen.
Healing. And I thank you.
For listening to Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Listen. Like I said, he ain't nervous. Neither am I. Amen. Whatever you got in your spirit. We all family here, right?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
This song simply says, by the hand of the Almighty, I've been made free.
Amen.
Healed, delivered, made complete. Now I'm walking in.
Victory.
All right. So repeat after me. By the hands of the Almighty.
By the hands of the Almighty.
I've been made free.
I've been made free.
Healed, delivered.
Healed, delivered.
Made complete.
Made complete.
Now I'm walking in victory.
Now I'm walking in victory.
All the words. All right. So it goes like this.
Come on, choir.
So, just bring the mic. So you guys repeat after me. So.
Set free, healed, delivered, made complete. Now I'm
walking in victory.
Prophetic though, because you're a
head. Please try your head.
It might go back into song, it might go into a bunch of other stuff. Just, let me get
this. Without further ado, our next speaker is Rose
Chasen.
All right, y'all.
All right, so don't get too serious now. I sat down, but I know how that do. Sometimes you get your serious face on, so really listening. I just feel, well, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I just thank you, Lord, that you anoint my tongue, God, that you anoint my communication, God, that they have ears to hear and eyes to see, Lord. I thank you that everyone in the room, including myself, be like a sponge today, God, soaking up every bit of every drop of everything you have for us today, God.
Hallelujah.
So I thank you for the connectivity through your Holy Spirit, God. I thank you for trust in you, God. I do trust you. I do trust you. And I will go where you want me to go, do what you want me to do, say what you want me to say, God. And I thank you that that is the heart of this people here. In Jesus' name, Lord, I thank you that everything that goes forward today will pierce the hearts of people who need it, God, that you know exactly what people need, God. And I thank you, Lord, that you you go to each person individually, speak what they're specifically in need of, God. And I thank you that there will be healing, deliverance, and fire in the name of Jesus over every being. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Praise God. All right, so, hey, y'all. It's been good. It's been a real blessing to be with you guys. It's always really, really cool. So I wanted to say this. It was interesting that, it was interesting that Pastor Josiah was talking about just birthing and stuff, because I was here for a prayer last Thursday, and that was what God gave me about this ministry, is that you guys were skilled at birthing, and that you guys were acquainted with birthing, but it wasn't just for that sake. It was because you were acquainted with intimacy.
Amen.
And you can't get pregnant without no intimacy. You just can't, you know, and I know a lot of us run from it. We be just trying to run away during the intimate times and those intimate seasons, but not everybody is always pregnant. You know, I know it sounds good in a church way. Not everybody is always pregnant, you know, because not everybody has spent time in intimacy with the Lord. So if you're running from it, slow down. Get you some intimacy. Get in the face of God. Let him minister to you and minister unto him. It's a two-way street. So, but God did share that with me about you guys, and it was something I realized, what was it, maybe last year or something like that, it was sometime 2018, that I was scared of intimacy. I had a fear of intimacy with God. I would get only but so close, or, you know, I would get close when people was around, but, like, by myself, it was like, I would get to this point, and I'd be like, all right, cool, that was dope, God, let me check out what YouTube's saying, like, you know, or go some other direction, but I had a fear of intimacy, and I'm still pushing past that. All these things I'm saying, you know, I know it don't sound all perfect or whatever else, because I got the mic, all these things I know are things that people go through, and what God revealed to me was I was scared of intimacy because I had God in this, like, human-sized box. Like, you know, I only know the experiences I know. Like, I know my father, my natural father experience, you know, and I was putting God in that type of box, and I had human disappointments that I was trying to put on God that he wasn't feeling, and that they weren't true at all. So still pushing past that, you know. The enemy likes to come back. You know, you get delivered from something, whatever. You come back around and he check and make sure you still delivered or whatever else. And if that house ain't filled, you know, then, you know, he has access. So I'm not giving him any access in Jesus' name. So, yeah, I just say that because this ministry's been such a blessing, even just by knowing Brother Moses here, been such a blessing to me personally, has spoken into my life more than he possibly could know. And whenever you guys are just servants. I was telling them, I was like, I can always tell your people, like, you know, whenever, I don't even know who went here specifically for a while, but when you guys were just around, I was like, oh, those got to be Moses people, like, you know, because they just all had a servant's heart. Everybody was just like, hey, brother, how you doing? Let me, you know, you need me to get some water? You can seem a little dry, you need some water, whatever. Everybody was just always willing to just help and, you know, be a servant, and just the way in which you guys do things. I think I met most of you guys first when Who Touched Me conference. I met most of you guys first there, and, you know, there was a lot of stuff going on that night as far as just the placement and where things were going, but there was like a flow, which was really cool, and I don't see that in a lot of places. So this is one of the churches I would go to if I wasn't going to my church. I would come here. Because y'all got a flow, and it just, you just guys go where the Holy Spirit leads you, and nobody ain't been out of shape about it. Y'all might have had attitudes, but I didn't see no attitudes, so praise God. I didn't see no attitudes, anything like that. Y'all just went with it. And there was a time where we were up in the, I think it was you up there too, in the upper room section. And that was hot too. That was like, that went in. I was like, oh, we just gonna stay up here? I was cool. But then we transitioned, praise God, we went downstairs and it was good, it was blessed. But I was like, we can just chill right here. We was good, it was nice. That nice little flow, that joint was tight in there and everything, it was nice. So, yeah, but praise God for you guys and for being the midwives that you are. Don't got full revelation of that yet, but I know that's what God showed me. And then when he showed him that today, I was literally, this is what I thought, y'all. This is, I mean, because I just dream big or imagine big, do my sanctified imagination. And God just stretches me in those ways. So he's just been working with me with words of knowledge and stuff like that recently more than probably ever. I've had them before, but it's just been on increase. So I was seeing a baby that was dead. And somebody brought the baby up to me. I hadn't even been to this building yet, so I didn't know what it looked like. But I was in a service. I had the mic, and somebody brought a baby up to me. And I sang over the baby, and the baby was like, it was good. It was straight. So, but here I am, like, God, there's gonna be a dead baby in the church. Sorry, that's mad and sensitive sounding, but that's what my thought was. I was just like, all right, well, God, you know, if you showed it to me, if he reveals it, he can heal it. And that's always been my way. So if God tells me something, I go out on it and I'm saying it, all right, cool. Especially if I find out it's true, then I'll, oh, bet. Like, we're good. Like, God's gonna heal it. God's gonna touch whatever the situation was. so I didn't know it was gonna be spiritual. And I still don't know who that was, you know. But I believe by faith that when I put my faith out there on something, I don't waste it. You know, and that's just something that's one of the things that I wanted to talk to you guys about a little bit is when you... faith, it's power that you're letting out, you know. So when you let it out, who was it saying? Was it Brother Josiah that was saying that? No, I think it was you. You were saying that every word that comes out of your mouth. So who said that? Somebody said that whatever comes out of your mouth, the anointing will attach to it. That was Brother Josiah, right?
That's Josiah, yep.
And I believe that very, very strongly. So I'm very careful with my words and what I say and how I speak, even in jest. Like, I don't say a lot of weird stuff, you know. I try not to even say I'm tired a lot, you know, because it's faith going out. My mouth was meant for faith, like, you know, and I tell my mom all the time, look, she's laughing at me, because she says some crazy stuff sometimes. We all do, right? So, but she calls me her little Holy Spirit, because I'm like, Mom, you can't say that. You can't. So, I'm really, really careful about what I say out of my mouth. So when it comes time to exert faith, that my faith is all in one direction, that it's not scattered, that it's not split, it's not anyway. I'm speaking to you, and God said you're healed in Jesus' name, and that's it. And I just walk away, and we're good, right? But I put everything into it, and then I learned from a great man of God, I believe it was Kenneth Copeland, one of them was great, don't back off your faith. So when you pray and you speak something, what happens is a lot of the times we don't see the manifestation of it. Well, a lot of times we're speaking and praying for a miracle and we don't see a miracle. You know, we may see healing later on, but we're expecting to see like a leg out right in front of us, you know, which is good. And God does that. Amen. But when you don't, then what do you say? You know, you say amen and you call it a day. You keep believing, you keep speaking. So even if you don't see the healing there, I pray for many of people. and I don't see it there. And I have just bulldog faith. Like, I do not let go. When I get a bone, I do not let go. So that's another encouragement I want you guys to know, of course. And you guys are probably super, super saved. So this is probably regular business for you, right? don't let it go. When you grab hold of something, do not let it go. Until you leave this earth and you find out what happened, right? I don't let it go. So if I prayed over somebody, if I prayed over any of you guys, I stand in belief still to this day. So, you know, like when we come from a meeting and, you know, God's speaking and God's moving and maybe somebody said something out in the atmosphere. It wasn't specific to you. Like somebody didn't call you up and say, brother in the green, stand up. I got a word for you. They just said a general word, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you had the opportunity to connect your faith with it.
Amen.
Right? And then after the meeting, what do we say sometimes if it wasn't like that feeling, right? If it wasn't just like everybody was like falling out and doing all that other stuff, right? You didn't walk out like that. What do we say? Oh, it was all right. I don't know.
Right.
It was all right, you know, or I ain't get a word.
Oh, yeah.
You done killed it already.
Right.
You killed it before it even had a chance to really grow inside of you. Mm-hmm. I didn't get a word. Yeah, you did. You were sitting up in that room. If you believe in divine appointment and divine encounter, unless you just be going places. I don't just be going places. I don't be like and sit up in a whole bunch of services just for service sake. Like, I love people. I love God's people. But I'd rather be out doing something. So if it's a service, you know, I'm pretty particular about, like, you know, what I say yes, I'm going to come to. Like, I'll be like, I'll let you know. And I'll put it in my calendar or something. And I'll pray about it and I'll go. Or I just don't. Like, I'm not going to be there. Yeah, I won't be there. So, but when you go somewhere, you know, the expectation is that you're going to get blessed. Right. So don't pull back on your faith.
Right.
You know, when you receive something, receive it.
Right.
You know, what is receiving other than taking?
Right.
You know, so if I give you this pen to receive it, you got to take it. You can't, like, you know, I can't. You know, you don't have to take it. Like, you don't have to take healing, right?
Right.
If you don't believe in healing, you don't never got to worry about it.
Right.
You ain't going to be healed.
Right. Right.
If you don't want to take it, God's not going to force it on you,
right.
You know?
Right.
So
right.
Being really diligent about listening to where you're going to go and where you're going to be and things like that, and then knowing that when you're there and wherever you go, if something is spoken out, that you know in the atmosphere prophetically or whatever else, that you can attach yourself to that, and then you don't pull back on it by just regular casual talking.
Wow. Amen.
I just try really, really not to do casual talking because I've seen it come back on me.
Amen.
You know, the courts of heaven is a really, really serious thing, and there's a book by Robert Henderson. Get it, read it. Learn to love it. It'll change your whole prayer life. But it just basically talks about prayer and what prayer is and how it's not the battlefield that we all think, like, oh, I'm just on the battlefield praying, that it's all built around the court system, that everything you enter into his courts with praise and whatever else.
Wow.
Everything in the Bible prayer wise starts in the courtroom.
Mm-hmm.
And God is a judge. He's a father, but he's also a judge.
Yes.
Right. And then it says also that Jesus is our intercessor, our advocate, our lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And then it also says that the enemy is our accuser.
Right.
Right? So when we go into the courts of heaven, what the enemy is using against us sometimes and what we hold on to, you look like my cousin. Sorry, thank you, God, for my cousin Barbara Ann, God. Thank you for her. She was just out of the hospital, Lord. I thank you that you're chasing after her, God. That you are chasing after her, bringing healing to her in Jesus' name, where there's nothing missing and nothing broken from the inside, God. Every eternal, internal soul wound in the name of Jesus. I thank you that you conquered it right now in Jesus' name. That there is fullness in life, God, and we will see it here on this earth, God. I rebuke bitterness. I speak against bitterness and anger and rage. I thank you that you soothe it right now in the name of Jesus and remove it. Thank you for freedom for my cousin. And for you, in Jesus' name. I don't know if none of that was you, but you reminded me of my cousin, and I just went for it. Amen. Thank you, God. That's it. You know, see something. What I'm going to get into is kind of similar to that. You know, it's about seeing, you know, the eye of faith, the hand of faith, and things of that nature. So when you see something, sometimes it ain't just you seeing it. I looked at her about 3-4 times, and she literally looks like my cousin. She older than you, so, but like, you guys got the same eyes and everything. And when something keeps sometimes it's not always just our natural thing. Like, it's right. not, the spirit realm is active all the time.
Yes.
So if you're not sensitive to that, then you can miss the moment. And you can say it's weird that I'm gonna pray for her and she ain't even my cousin, whatever else, but my cousin's blessed and she's blessed. Amen. Amen. That's how I see it. And that's how I see it. Amen. Case closed. So, anyway, so, what was I saying? Your words that you speak. Yes, the courtroom. The courtroom. Yes. The courtroom. So the devil is accusing, and he's constantly accusing. But God, Jesus is also constantly interceding for us, right? So with one, there is the other. And what I found, and he was telling about his testimony, and what I found is that a lot of the things that he's accusing us of are our words.
Wow.
Our words. Authority is a really, really serious thing. My mom has authority over me as like she has connection to me. She can speak into my life because she's my mom. Like, you know, like, and she has authority over certain things in my life, you know, that I'm older and stuff like that. But, you know, especially when I was a kid. So if she was running around calling me bad, that's what the enemy's using to accuse me. His mom even said it. She's got authority over him, and she's even saying he's bad. So I got legal right to bring bad upon him. You know, I got legal right, and I have legal access to that part of his life in whatever way. Wow. Because his mom's given me access.
Wow. I didn't say that.
She didn't say that. She was real serious about that. She ain't let nobody call us bad. We don't call kids bad. You know, she ain't let us call bad. That was just an example. Praise God. But so words are very, very important. Words are very important. So think about the things that you've even spoken over your family members, the people that you're disappointed with, you know, oh, that old sorry Larry, oh, that so-and-so. The enemy's taking that. And we can say very easily, okay, I was just joking. Ain't that deep. It's not that deep, right? So you're telling me that Satan is sitting there like, oh, she said he was bad. Oh, she was just joking. Let's wait until she say it for real, and then I'm going to get on it. Yeah, right. He's like, oh, she said he's bad. Cool. It came out of her mouth, her anointed, sanctified mouth that has authority, that has power. I'm going to take it. She thought she was joking, but I was pretty serious, so I'm going to use that. If you don't got nothing nice to say, what they used to say, don't say nothing at all. Keep that mouth closed, right? Because I don't want to be a party to somebody's accusation, accusation. You know, I don't want to be a party to that. I don't want to, you know, be in any courtroom and they're like, oh, Jason said, you know, it comes with knowing positioning and it comes with knowing who you are. And if you are created in God's image, what you speak matters. It's power in your tongue. It's very, very serious and it's very important. I'm all over the place. Ain't nothing on this note, on these notes. So we're just going to flow with where God goes. Amen. So, oh yeah, when I speak in faith, I don't go back on it. I don't pull back. And when I hear in faith, I don't let go. Like, once it's out there, I do not let go. Especially if it's word, like if it's his word, then what are we letting go for? You know, we find a lot of cop outs because we don't see what we want to see. And I really, really appreciate him. And I was just talking to Matt about that, about Pastor Josiah. Just, we hear all the healing stories. We hear a lot of miracle stories. And, you know, Benny Hinn did it. Sid Roth prayed for 1,000 people before he ever saw one healing.
Good example.
Are we willing to do that much? Are we willing to let ourselves go enough? Because really, a lot of the times when we go up to pray for somebody, it's us. Like, I got the healing hands, God said. There's fire in my hands. I'll touch you and I'm gonna blow on you and then it's gonna happen, right? And when it don't happen, you know, how many times will we go with that same energy? You know, the young kids say, you ain't come with that energy to me. You know, how many times you gonna go with that same energy if it don't happen? Right? So I've been blessed and gracious enough that I've had people go before me that have paved the way and that have sown those seeds, and I'm reaping. And with that word that you gave to me on my ordination, I'm just realizing some of what that means. I'm reaping what I didn't even sow. Like, I'm harvesting, you know, like things that my mom, you know, and people before me had sown. Growing up on Benny Hinn and things like that, there's things that I have access to that he didn't initially have access to.
Right.
But because he got the revelation, I listened to the revelation and it got here, and I just ran with it with a childlike faith, have access to those things. So when I go to pray for people, I've seen probably 90% success. But there are those times that are extremely trying. And when he said, I always called it seed, but he said tithe.
Yeah, right.
That was huge.
Wow.
I was just talking to somebody about that before. I was just, because they were asking me, like, you know, we pray for people, you know, and then it doesn't happen, or has it ever not happened, or whatever else. That's not my focus at all. I go in, and we are to go in as if it will happen. And in full faith that it will happen, because that's just the word. The rest of the stuff is our understanding has to catch up to it. And sometimes we may not get understanding here. So I've resolved that. You know, I had, and Kevin remembers, I had a really... So I grew up arts and theater and singing and acting and dancing and stuff like that. So when I got out of high school, that was immediately what I wanted to do. Like, what, I was a wreck though. Like, I was trifling, y'all. Like, I was bad. So I didn't really need, thank God I didn't move up to New York like I wanted to right after high school. I was like, gonna go up, be poor, live the artist life, and, you know, be on Broadway somewhere or whatever. But God saw differently, amen. So, yeah, so I had this season where I was just auditioning after audition and show after show and, you know, really big stuff and then really small stuff. I was just working, just doing a whole bunch of stuff and, like, striving and doing my own thing. And I thought, oh, I got all these gifts. I got to use them all at one time. Like, you know, I just got to use them all. Like, it's, so I did that for a really long time. I met Kevin's wife and I was doing Dreamgirls. And... that was the season. It was very integral. I have no idea why I'm telling you all this, but praise God. very integral because it was an opportunity for me to continue down a path that I had no business going down, right? So I met her, and you know how you meet certain people, and you're like, oh, shoot, you know me, I can't wild out. You know, like, you know the Jesus in me, so I can't really go, like, with the rest of the crowd. Like, you know, we were both in our different places, whatever else, but, you know, it was a real blessing to have her around because, you know, if he was drinking, he could only drink but so much because, dang, Danielle around, she know, like, I know her dad's a whole pastor or, like, you know, she knows, she, you know, when somebody just knows you, like, you're a little deeper than this, bro. Stop trying to, you know, stop trying to hang, you know. So, I was trying to hang and whatever else, and I praise God for the friendships that he set, like, so strategically in my life during that season that didn't let me go but so far. Because I was called to be a man of faith, and that's just it. A man of fire and a man of faith since I was very young, and I kicked against it for so long. I used to ask God, like, you know, God, if I'm saved since I was, like, five, like, what's going to be my testimony? That's whack. Like, how am I going to even save people, like, if I'm all in the church the whole time? Dumb. Real dumb, because I got a testimony real quick, like I said, and it was not fun at all. So, it was not fun. Real dumb. Don't ever tell your kids not to pray that stupidness. So, yeah. So anyway, so I was in that season, and then I was just working. You know, I was leading worship at my church, sort of. I was doing stuff at the church, sort of. Not that it's about, you know, but it is about serving and about listening to God. And man, I was going through just a whole bunch of sin, just racking them, like just doing a whole bunch of stuff and still acting, still doing all that other stuff and getting nowhere. Just getting nowhere. Mild successes. Like, if you ask me to do a show, I'm like, oh, Jason, we really need your voice. I'll be so flattered. And it could be a show about, like, not a show about, like, demons or nothing like that. And I knew that was, like, too much for me, right? But, you know, I'll do these fake check-ins with God, like, you know, God, should I really do this or whatever else? You know, I'm going to do it anyway. Right? Anyway. God spoke, right? Yeah. It's fake. So, you know, and then the concept, I would see people, you know, and God was starting to minister to me that your gift will make room for you, right? So people always say, you know, well, if this door opens, then that means God opened it for me. Or, you know, if I get this role or if I get this gig, then that means obviously God wanted it for me. And I always thought that was dumb, but I would kind of do it anyway. Because the Bible says your gift will make room for you. So what if all the doors open?
Wow.
Right. Would you gonna go through all of them?
Right.
Like you,
right.
You still have to be obedient to God as far as what you choose in your life. So running, choosing all the wrong things and like 9 shows at a time, stressing myself out, didn't have money, wasn't trying to work and a whole bunch of other stuff. So then God just kept telling me to slow down. Okay, I quit a show or two, right? And I still had like 3 more, right? So I'm like, yeah, slow down. And then church stuff was kind of picking up or whatever else. So long story short, I'm at, like this little cabaret night. We used to just drink and sing and stuff, right? It was the, sorry y'all, is this not saved enough?
What?
Is this not saved enough? All right, cool, because everybody was just quiet like, what? For a minute still?
He's trying to say now,
oh, you're trying to badge me doing it? Let me show you. I was just like, no. No, so I was kind of drunk, but not really. I was just a little wine, whatever. So we were driving home. Then I got this call, frantic. It was my friend's mom calling me and just crying. And I immediately knew something was wrong. It's my best friend. She was like, Jason, Sharice got into an accident. And I don't know. I was like, did she make it? Did she, like, is she okay? You know, like, I'm trying to get all these details. So, she's got an accident. I need Heaven's, my other friend Heaven. I need her mom's number. Do you know how to get it? So I called my friend Sherman to get whatever. It was just a whole bunch of stuff. Now I'm driving and I'm on the phone, little tipsy, you know, whatever else. And my friend's behind me. I'm swerving everywhere. To me, I don't see any of this. And they're beeping, trying to figure out what's going on. So then I finally stopped the car just to kind of like, because, you know, this was as unto death kind of stuff. Like, I knew it was very, very serious. And, so anyway, she was in a car accident, friend was driving, and I was supposed to be in the car with them, actually. I was supposed to be at that party, but I chose something else that night. So it was my friend's birthday party, it was a DJ, and she was in the car with him, but we would always do that, like, you know, like, he was a safe drunk driver, like, you know, like, he was drunk, but you could never tell, that type of weird stuff. And then, you know, we would trust him, whatever. Got into an accident, flipped the car, the gas tank went on fire. So they were trying to save Sharice, my friend, and her sister was in the front seat. He was driving, and then my other friend was in the back. Multiple people just trying to save her. Heaven got burnt really bad in her arm, but Sharice was the only one that was in a coma. She was just like, not here. So in that season, right, I'm in a show at the, like, two or three shows or something at that time, and I'm just trying to process. And I remember, you know, I was in the show with Danielle at that time. It was Barnum, and it was like a circus show. And then I would be praying every, you know, and they were doing the best they can. Oh, you're my thoughts, my prayers, the cast and stuff, you know. I'm like, I don't want your thoughts, like, you know, pray, you know. So you're my thoughts and prayers or whatever else. So it was a really tough experience. I had to keep going, all the stuff that I had set up in my life, you know, all the stuff I had to keep going, and then still put faith towards this thing, you know. So I was then being confronted with my two lives, the things that I compartmentalized for so long. Wow. You know, Jesus and art didn't go together. God and whatever I was doing didn't go together all the time, like, unless it was like something really, you know, where I couldn't deny it. So, you know, I'm at you know, shows, I'm coming late, and, you know, I'm doing all the stuff you got to do to get ready, but I'm like not there, and I'm praying with Danielle. She's giving me scripture, and I'm just trying to push through. It was like a 2-week, 3-week period of time where I had never prayed that much in my life at that point. I was blowing people up. If you ask my mom's friends and a whole bunch of people, I was like every 2 seconds, I would get an update, pray for this, whatever. You know, she had lost her fingers at a certain point. They had to, you know, because they would die, the body parts die off and whatever else. And through a series of just different things, I was able to go in the room, and I was really scared to go in and see her because she was burnt 80 to 90% of her body. I think the only thing that wasn't burnt was her stomach, which they think because she was like this, you know. So anyway, I walked in and I was like, I've never seen anything like this, especially my friend. Mm-hmm. And I ain't recognize her. You know, if you ever seen somebody that was burnt, swollen beyond belief, and just lacerations and a whole bunch of other stuff, and it was just very, very surreal. So I go in, and, you know, we sang to her, and because her sisters, they used to sing in a group, sang to her, and just some, like, hymns or whatever else, and I saw her, you know, heart starting to respond. So I was like, oh, she's in there. That's so cool. So then I looked at her. I don't know if I prayed it or whatever else, but God, because I couldn't see her face. She didn't look like her. Almost so much that I thought, like, maybe I was in the wrong room. Didn't recognize her at all. She was huge, like, you know. And so I looked at her, and God showed me her face. And I was just so blessed that I just saw she's in there. And God's got, like, that. God's got her. So through that time, you know, I've been praying, and just put my faith towards this. And, you know, though I wasn't living right and whatever else, faith was faith to me. Like, this girl's going to be healed. Like, you know, we all going, I knew how serious it was, but to me, it just didn't matter. I had a childlike faith. I was just like, she's going to be brand new. And there was prophecy that went forth. And like, you know, I saw Cherise dance. She was a dancer. I saw her dancing in heaven and with skin like a baby. Nobody said she was going to go to heaven. Like, you know, they said they just saw her being ministered to by the Lord and her ministered to the Lord up there. I'm like, all right, cool. Bring that on down. You know, bring it down here. And, you know, let's see your dance in real life. Right. So, you know, somebody had brought, you know, the prayer cloth thing and everything. And then there was like opposition. There was like a lot. She was in a sorority. Sorry if you're in a sorority. But there was like some really heavy opposition there spiritually. It seemed like they just swarmed in, you know, like, you know, it was just really strange. So I had some forgiveness to do with that. And so they wouldn't let the prayer cloth come in because we had somebody pray for it, you know, and whatever else. And people were seeing visions of her, like, in Atlanta. There was a conference going on in Atlanta. So I called my pastors, like, I need something, like a word or something. They were like, oh, actually, somebody just had a word about Cherise, you know, in Atlanta. So I'm passing it to the mom. And there was just all these, like, highs and lows. And so long story short, all this prayer and all this whatever, there was just highs and lows. Then I got a call one morning from heaven. She had gotten out. Her burns were bad, but, you know, she lost all her hair and stuff, but she was able to get out and whatever. She called me. She said, Cherise is bad. She's gone. So, you know, all this prayer that I'm putting towards it, all these people that I'm having pray and whatever else, and then it's just like, wow, you know, all that and nothing. All this faith exerted and nothing. And that was before I really started like going out and praying for people and doing all that other stuff. This is kind of like the genesis of it, but I always believed in prayer. Like when we were little, we used to just pray in tongues and pray for people, whatever. It was just a thing that we did. We knew God worked in that way. So, then, you know, after dealing with that, 2 weeks later, I'm in rehearsal, and didn't know my lines or something, and the director just went off on me after knowing all that was going on. They were trying to be all supportive, like, oh, we're going to dedicate the show to her and whatever else. I showed up, and I didn't know my lines, and he, like, reamed me out. So, like, it was a bad night. So I was thinking, I was like, should I even be doing this? And this was Rent. I was casting Rent, and they just had asked me to do this other part because somebody else, and that was a part that was a little compromised, you know, like in what I should have been doing. But at that time, I was just going to pray about it briefly, right? Seek the Lord for a little bit and, you know, like do whatever I wanted. So thank God that it didn't happen that way. But, you know, so they had just offered me that part, just got yelled at, there was like a whole bunch of stuff. And I was like flipping out. And I don't know, I'm really professional, like on set and whatever else. I like took my script and I was like, like really. It wasn't me. Like, I wasn't myself, and I knew I needed to stop, and he had been telling me to slow down. I get home that night, and my dad had been calling me, and we had a strained relationship, but we were good. We fixed it, but I had to get used to having a dad again. Like, we just didn't talk that often anymore. So we were good, but he had been calling me. I'm like, dad's a talker. Like, let me call him back later. So I never called him back, and so I got a call from him in the car, and it wasn't his voice. It was some lady's voice, so I knew immediately that there was something wrong. So this is 2 weeks after, and I get a call, and dad's dead. He's gone. So, so dealing with that, and, you know, it just felt like at that season, everybody around me was dying. I was just like, I can't even catch a break. Like, I've never experienced people close to me dying, you know. Right. And so, you know, I didn't even have a chance to exert faith in that way, you know, and that just was like, you know, though in years past, you know, I prayed for him and whatever else. And I believe he went to heaven, but it was just a bad season. So I had to stop. I had to slow down. And I came to the end of myself. And through that period of time, God just took all the gifts that I was using and all the things that I was doing, snatched them away. Like, just I couldn't act. I couldn't sing. I couldn't be in no shows. I couldn't do anything. It owned me. It like literally was my life. So, and I would do it over what God was calling me and asking me to do. It had ownership. So he had to strip all that stuff from me because it was my identity. Like, you know, it was what I did to please. It was what I did to, you know, be a part and whatever else. Stripped all that stuff to me. And all I could do for about 5 years to 6 years is just worship. Wow. Just led worship. And that's it. That's all I was released to do. I would literally try. I'd be like, oh, good. Color Purple having an audition. Let me jump up in that. Never worked out. Oh, let me audition for this. Never worked out. It just never worked out, ever. So I just said, you know what, God? If you never, ever let me do any of this stuff ever again, I'm okay.
Right.
And at that point, I knew it didn't own me because that was serious. That was a serious thing to say to God. It's like, if you never give this back to me, I'm good. I know what you have for me is better. And if it will fulfill me better. So that was that journey that I then at that point when I was giving God those pieces of my life, I was literally beginning to grow in faith and grow in trust with God and lean on him and rest on him for whatever I needed and for my career, my life, whatever had for me. To go to what he was saying, that was seed. You know, I didn't know that was seed for the ministry that God had for me in the future. To pray for like 2 to 3 weeks fervently, like I just was in prayer. Like I was literally seeking God every single moment. If anybody had a prophetic word about something for her, I was just like, okay. Like, you know, I've never been that diligent about prayer in my prayer life ever before. So it taught me something, but it was something that didn't work out the way I thought it would. Then I realized what choice and timing meant. Somebody revealed to me prophetically that, you know, because I was still holding on to bitterness and anger because I thought she didn't get healed because somebody didn't put the prayer cloth in the room, you know, or somebody didn't do what the Lord was asking them to do. And, you know, because there were several instructions that went forth in that time, you know, prophecy can be conditional and nobody did any of them. So I was just like, y'all gonna let her die just because y'all afraid to be like spiritual? Like y'all afraid to be real Christians? Like they were Christians, but whatever. So, anyway, during that season, I learned and the Lord revealed to me that there's choice. So when you don't cease, and this is not a cop out, this is not something that's always the case, but in large part, I've realized that there is a choice. And somebody expressed to me prophetically that Charisse had a choice when she got up there, when she met with God and she was, you know, he was ministering to her or whatever else. She had a choice to stay here or go. And she chose the better of the two options. And I believe that's true for a lot of the things that we don't see. And people always say, you know, they get their healing one way or the other, either here or else, you know. And then, right. And praise God, they do. Right. But how many people raise your hands if that ever felt like a cop-out to you?
Right.
Anybody? I'm by myself?
Right.
It felt like a little bit of a cop-out, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't have the answer for that, so praise God. But, you know, it's not the cop-out that we think. God's still true, God's still real, and God's still moving, and he's still active. So over the years in learning that and developing in that there was a choice that happened and that she did receive her healing, my faith grew in those areas despite, you know, just kind of what those different things were and what happened to me in those ways. faith grew in those areas and just learning to trust God for who he was, period, without any question, without any cop out, anything. He was who he was and he was good, and that's it. That revelation is something I don't think we're always at as much as we say and as much as we think, you know. I think we can create the cop-outs for ourselves in our minds, like, oh, God's good, but nah, he's just good. He's just good. Our understanding has not caught up to it yet. So what I wanted to talk about is, hopefully that ministered to somebody, but what I wanted to talk about is the eye of faith. The eye of faith and the hand of faith and what they mean. So I've been kind of, you know, like I said, God's been dealing with me more with like, you know, words of knowledge and things like that and pictures and stuff recently. But I always, and it's just interesting that he said it because I was like, dang, he kind of stole a little bit of what I was going to say, right? but God's been dealing with me about your sanctified imagination.
Amen.
Using the things that he's giving you in your mind, how your mind works. How many people imagine bad things? Tragic accidents, diseases from germs and stuff, and just weird stuff, right? We can imagine really, really weird stuff. I heard some conversation, I stole it.
I'm delivering.
Set free.
Set free. Set free.
Excuse me. So, as much as that's a thing, you know, imagining the bad things and, you know, how normal that can be to us sometimes, just kind of imagining and expecting the worst, that has to have a reverse. Yes. It has to have an opposite, that's right? So, meaning, why not, when we go to pray for people, let's imagine. Yeah. Let's just imagine. Take God out the box, destroy the box even, and let's imagine what God can do and will do and already has done for this person that we're going to pray for or whatever else. So let's see. Did anybody go out and pray for anybody while we were going?
Yes.
Come on. Tell us about it while we're going. No. On lunch, anybody go and pray?
This young lady right here.
You did? All right, hit us with it. What was it?
Well, okay, so I was going to Chick-fil-A. And, you know, Chick-fil-A has a long line, right? So this one had a long line, too.
Bless.
And I said, Lord, you know, Chick-fil-A got a long line here again. So I said, you know what? I'm going to exercise my faith, and I'm going to pray that the line just starts moving like crazy, mm-hmm. right? Because, you know, Chick-fil-A lines, they take forever. Mm-hmm. But they're really good service. Mm-hmm. So as I was praying for the line to just kind of speed up and go faster, I found that my prayers started even shifting to the people that were in the car, because Holy Spirit put in my heart that some people were frustrated at how long they had to wait for the line. So I said, Lord, I'm just praying for the people so they don't have to be frustrated and da, 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 you know, and all of a sudden, I'm not even lying, that one car after another just started moving out of the line. Mm-hmm. And before I'm just driving, and all of a sudden, another line, like another speaker lane opened up, and like we were able to move in there, and it was just moving really fast.
Chick-fil-A and the Lord. So imagine if we could have imagined that first before we complain. You know, imagine if we could imagine that before we do anything else, before we pray. You know, God's good. He'll catch us up. You know, sometimes we just, you know, be a little slow on the draw. But imagine if we can imagine what he's going to do before we go forward and pray. Wow. We can have it all set here and say, oh, God, but what if you can grow her leg out? But if you grow it out and put a heel on it as well, or put a shoe on it or something, right? You know? That sounds silly, but, you know, kind of along the lines, right? We can say there's no purpose in that or whatever else, right? But what I'm saying is just for an example, you know, like, we would have thought this world would have been crazy to create if we had been there when God created it, because there was no evidence of it before. There was no framework. There was no like blueprint of it. We would have never seen it before. But when he spoke the world into existence, then it was. We just living in it now, right? So it's regular to us in a lot of ways. But these creative miracles and these things that we want to see in this next season, they're going to start here in our sanctified imagination and here in your spirit. So really developing that and letting God, and trying God in that and saying, all right, God, you know you're going to heal him. How you want to do it this time? Let it be fun. You know, enjoy that process. See it with the eye of faith. The hand of faith cannot take what the eye of faith cannot see.
Amen. That's good.
So you have to see it first before you can take it. Right? And there's been times we've seen it, we've not known, and, you know, we've gotten the harvest or whatever else. But in this season, as we're going forward, I think it's really, really important to know and to exercise our faith in that way for the creative miracles that God wants to do and is desiring to do in this season. I think we got to see some stuff. Right. We got to unbox him a little bit. Yeah. And hey, you might imagine something, he do something crazier. Yeah. Or he don't do that at all, but praise God, he did it. Right. You know, but then sometimes he'll match that thing. Amen. You know, I was praying for, I ran into this guy that I went to high school with. It was a season where I was just dealing with a whole bunch of overdoses and like a whole bunch of, it was like, oh, actually, a whole bunch is two. But to me, that's enough, right? It was a whole bunch of stuff. And then two overdoses that I was dealing with at one time. There was a season at my job where people were just coming in. And this pregnant lady came in and had a seizure at my job. So I had to go over and pray for her. There's this lady that came in and she was choking. They come all the way from the beach. I work at a hotel. They come all the way from the restaurant, come all the way in the back, pass her to come get me because she's choking. I'm like, but did you do anything? She's choking. I'm like, where? And she's all the way across. So I run over and give her the Heimlich. Pray for her. Whatever, right? Guy's nose just started randomly beating. This every accident that could happen at the job, I was there for. And I just would put my faith out towards it and just expect. The little boy that ran away. Oh, man. It was this little boy that ran up. It was almost, it was very weird. Ran up, said, hey, can I use your phone? Said, all right, cool. Go ahead. So he uses my phone at the desk, and then he just walks off. And I'm like, all right. So I was like, let me go follow this little boy. I'm like, where are his parents at? Like, who just sends their kid? And so I go follow, and I'm looking at him like, I said, where's your parents or whatever? And something happened. They called, the grandparents called and said, did a little boy just come up to you? I'm like, yeah. How did, where you at? Like, so she's like, we're in a hotel across, now I work in Atlantic City, so it's not, in the, I don't work in a nice, amazing neighborhood. So they saw him from the neighboring, like two, three hotels, like four blocks down, saw him walk into the building, and she's like, go catch him, go grab him. So I go grab him and call the police. I had him, you know, kind of playing games, you know, entertaining him. But I knew there was something off. There was something wrong. I could just tell molestation was on him. I could just tell there was anger, rage, and spirit of murder on him. A whole bunch of stuff. And this boy was like 8. Yeah. And he's like 8 or 9, I think, like that. So I was able to... I waited for the police to come, and I was just able to talk to him and kind of minister to him. And then the police got there, and I just got ordained recently, so I didn't really have. We're all ministers of the gospel, amen. Yeah. And I've always just believed that, so I didn't really need no title or anything like that. But it does help now because I can be official. So the police came, and I was just like, "Hey, can I just talk to him really quick?" I said, "I just need to talk to him real quick. I'm a minister, yeah." And it was like, oh, okay, cool. So I just, you know, took him in there, and I was able to lead him to the Lord in the room, which was a blessing. It's amazing. So I don't know what, you know, I kept up with his grandmom a little bit and, you know, gave her some tools. You know, I was being wise because he also had a history of, she wanted me to, like, mentor him and stuff like that. And he lived in, like, somewhere. I was like, I'm not touching that right now. Like, you know, because he had a history of, you know, I'm a male. He had a history of, like, lying about sexual things that would happen, you know, so walk in wisdom, guys. So I gave her the tools that, you know, I felt like I'd had, whatever. So hopefully and prayerfully, I know that something, it was seed planted in his life, and there's something awesome on him, and I'm excited to later on, maybe even in heaven, see the fulfillment of that. Anyway, so I was talking about all the stuff that happened at work. At that season, there was a lot of stuff going on where people were just coming in. And this guy, I was having to come home from church. I wasn't at work that time. He was dragging this guy down the street, and he was like falling in the street. And I was just like, do you need help? And the guy was like, no, I'm good. I'm good. So I'm like, all right, because it seemed like you need help. So I stopped and I turned around. And I looked at him, and then I'd never seen somebody. He needed help more than what that situation was. He was trying to get this guy that was overdosed and overdosing to the hospital, but the hospital was like 4 or 5 blocks away. Like, I just passed the hospital and he was passing me. So I turned around to him and he reaches out his hand, and like the look in a grown man's face when they need help. Yes. He said, yeah, I need help. Like, so I go over and, you know, I'm a pro now because it's my second overdose. So I'm like, it's gonna be all right, you know. You know. So another thing, guys, when I go into a situation or when something's happening, you got the answer right here.
Yeah, right.
You have the answer right here. And stuff like this used to wear me out, blood and whatever. You wouldn't believe some of the stuff I see now. I'm just like, eh. You know, but like, you have the answer. So that stuff was kind of scare me when I would go to it now. I run into it now. Like, there's this power and this grace on me to do whatever God's called me to do in that season. And I just literally tell him, you're going to be all right. You ain't going to die because I'm here. I'm here and the Holy Spirit's here with me. So, like, you're good. You came to the right place to die because it's not going to happen the way you think it's going to happen, right? So I talked to him and whatever else. Guy ended up, ambulance came. He wasn't even the issue. He wasn't even the issue. Ambulance took him. I never saw him again. But the guy that I went to high school with, we found out, was the guy that was trying to help him out. Now he's bald now, and I'm like, oh, okay, that's an interesting choice for a young fella, you know. So so we're talking, and he was just like, you know, I just started to minister to him and just talk to him about God. He was like, it's so interesting, this lady at work keeps telling me God's coming, like God wants to reveal himself to you or something and whatever, and I've been just, I can't stop thinking about him. So, you know, I'm walking, and I walk past my house. I walk him all the way to this other bad neighborhood, Atlantic City, and we're just talking. I'm just ministering to him and led him to the Lord, but the Lord asked me to ask him if he needed prayer for anything, if he needed healing, and he didn't look sick. Like, I didn't know what was going on. I just was like, do you need prayer or anything? And he said, yeah, I do. I got alopecia, and and he was like, it didn't bother me before. Like, I'm not that vain. But he was like, it's starting to bother me now because it was in patches. That's why he shaved his head. And I could look closer and see that there were patches that were like pink. And then there was ones that were like more the color of his head or white or something. It was just patchy. You could tell. And he was just like, it's starting to bother me now. I'm looking in the mirror and I can't really deal with it. And I was just kind of disappointed about it. I was just like, I ain't never prayed for no alopecia before, but here we go, right? So he was saved by then too, and you know, healing is the children's bread, so he's now a child. So I was like, all right, come on. So we prayed, and I didn't see his hair grow out there, you know what I mean? I didn't see it happen as a miraculous thing there, but I left, and I said, okay, cool. Homeboy gonna have some hair next time I see him. And that was it. So he worked at like Crocs or something. And I just kept feeling it. I was texting him back and forth. I kept feeling I need to go and talk to him. He didn't say anything. We've been texting back and forth. I go into the job and this dude has hair on his head. Yes. But the thing was crazy about it was the hair didn't grow back regularly. It grew back white. Wow. Only the spots that he had alopecia grew back white. Everything. I wish I took a picture of his head, but like, I didn't get it. He saw it. My mom saw it.
I was like, oh, I saw it that night too.
Yeah.
I ended up seeing it. I was like, ooh.
It grew in white. The rest of his hair is black, and it just grew in patchy, like white. And I was just like, wow. You know, God's hand was on him, and God didn't want him to forget. You know, so healing manifests in different ways sometimes. Yes, yes. And if we box God into what ways that we want him to heal, you know, without using our sanctified imagination, because he'll speak to that. Right. And he'll say, oh, I'm going to heal it, but I'm gonna put some white hair on it because I think that's cool, right? Yes. You know, and he just like did his little God thing, and the guy has white hair now, you know, but it's always a testimony everywhere he goes. You know, his hair was not supposed to grow. And I go back and I get verification because, you know, people be hyped up on stuff and they try to hype you up. So I'm like, so you really couldn't grow hair, right? I'm like, what did the doctor say? Like, what did they say? Like, was it a little bit of a change? He was like, absolutely not. It was not supposed to grow ever again. And it was spreading, actually. So praise God for that. You know, you go, you do what you feel like, especially, oh, my God. And there's times where he doesn't reveal or he doesn't like give you a word of knowledge and you have to go forward anyway.
Yeah.
But the times when he does,
bro, you got to get all over it. You
right.
have to get all over it, because if he's revealing it, he's going to heal it.
Right.
And that's it. So, you know, move forward without that as well. You know, you don't want to get hopped up on that. But, you know, leaning and trusting on God in the off season when you're not on the field is really, really, really important. Was it Peter or was it John that leaned on Jesus? Peter?
John.
It was John, the one he loved. So John was leaning and reclining on Jesus. What does it mean to lean and recline? It's a symbol of rest. It's trust. It's leaning back on God and saying, all right, God, you got this. Imagine how comfy that would have been. Like, you know, you're eating and you're reclining on Jesus. Look at the positioning as well. Where was his ear?
On his heart.
Amen. Right? So his ear was tuned into the timing of the Lord.
Amen.
To the rhythm of heaven. So that when he leaned forward, he was then moving with the rhythm of heaven.
Right?
To the cadence of heaven. So it's really, really important that when we're not, when, you know, anybody have those dry spells when, you know, stuff don't seem like it's popping off, or, you know, you don't see as many things happening, or you don't see as many opportunities to go and pray for people and, you know, bring healing in that way. rest in the off season, like rest in the reclining season. Always rest, though. You know, you don't want to ever be doing things out of your own strength, but it's very important that we learn how to rest in those times, because those times are strengthening. In the waiting on the Lord, He renews our strength so that when we go forward with power. And now that we've gotten our tongues together, you know, we go forward and we speak things that we expect to happen, and then we go forward. We don't let it go. We hold on to it like a bone, like a dog with a bone. All right. Now, praise God, I ain't get to none of this. So let me see if there was any nuggets that God wanted to share with everybody. You guys blessed?
Yes.
I'm enjoying it.
Did you mention the hand of faith?
Thank you.
I'm on you.
You on it. So the hand of faith is as simple as that. It's as simple as what I just demonstrated. What's your name?
Mendel.
Brother Mendel. What I demonstrated with him was the hand of faith is receiving. It's receiving. You know, it's taking. Receiving is taking. You know, and when once you visualize something, once you use your imagination to say, all right, God, you can do this, you know, and you will do this. It's up to you then to take it, to take authority over it and say, okay, that's it. I got it. I saw it. It's something tangible in my eyes now. So now I can actually physically go and grab it. If that makes sense. So hand of faith, eye of faith, those work together. There's more of faiths, but I research all that. It's ear of faith and everything. Hearing, faith comes by hearing. It doesn't come by, one of the revelations I got was traumatic experiences try your faith. They do not bring faith. If traumatic experiences brought faith, we have more than enough faith.
Right.
We'd have all the faith we would ever need, right? If traumatic experiences was what it took to bring our faith. But faith comes by hearing. That's how it comes. So hearing, the ear of faith, I guess that's what that is. But so specifically the eye of faith and the hand of faith, envision and visualize what you believe God is wanting to do in that situation.
Amen.
Let him work through your imagination, and then grab it and don't let go. Don't let your faith get fat and slow. Meaning exercise it. Move your faith. We're doing it all the time. We put faith towards the worst stuff sometimes. You know, we're exercising faith. So being careful with what you speak out and what you exercise is very, very important. We have to be exercising faith. We have to be exercising faith. If you let it get stale and stagnant, it's something that's got to grow all the time. I don't think the same faith that was from 2 days ago is the same faith you have today.
Sure.
It's a constant thing.
Yeah.
You have to, you can't eat off, like, I done ate off of Burger King already. That's never going to feed me again.
Right.
I just had that. It's never going to feed me again.
Wow.
I have to sit in front of the word. I have to sit in front of it again and take another meal in.
Right.
I have to
wow.
put the word in front of me. That's the what the word was for yesterday, what the faith was for yesterday is not going to feed me for today.
Right.
It's fresh and it's new every day. So when you go, and I'll kind of close with this, I guess. Praise God, I didn't look at the time or anything. Am I good? Got to close up. Okay. It's 10? It's 10 o'clock? Woo! All right, I'm closing up. All right, so we can all go. Jesus cursed the fig tree. When he cursed the fig tree,
yes.
What he was doing was that thing wasn't in season to be even fruitful at that moment. But the blessing was on Jesus. The blessing was on him. So he was in expectation of fruit even out of season. When Jesus showed up, he expected it to be in harvest because the blessing was on him. So when you move forward, expect those things because the same blessing is on you. Expect harvest when you move forward. Right? And because it didn't yield the fruit that he wanted it to yield, even outside of its own season, I wouldn't blame the tree. Really, dang, it wasn't even in season, right? But the tree didn't yield the fruit, and he cursed it. And he left it alone, and that was just as simple as that. He cursed it, and he moved forward. And that was it. And then he came back, and it was dead. So know that there's power in your words. There's power in what you say. There's cursing and blessing in the tongue. And what you say matters. And the faith you put out in what you say matters. So, amen. Praise God. Thank you guys. You guys have been a blessing. Thanks, that's it. Amen.